A lot of PC developers get a ton of credit for their work on early 3D game engines. John Carmack and Tim Sweeney come to mind. For a number of reasons, we hear a lot less about the amazing work that was done by other visionary companies, usually in the console space. Today, I'm going to talk about an overlooked but amazing engine that has been rebuilt from scraps and the hobbyist team that put this back together. Folks, in my news videos, I've been very excited about the titles that Sony has been porting to PC. I'm obviously a huge fan of the PC platform, and I'd like to see more and more titles be natively ported. Today, I have a similar, but very, very different story. This isn't about The Last of Us, Spider-Man, or God of War. In fact, this video is going to be pretty different from the stuff I've made in the past. Today, I'm going to cover the recent decompilation and subsequent native port of the 2001 PlayStation 2 exclusive, Jak and Daxter, the Precursor Legacy. This is a hobbyist project that's gotten some attention as of late. I managed to get the native port up and running on the Steam Deck pretty easily, so I want to talk about how to get it up and running, compare it to emulating on the PS2, tell you what kind of performance you can expect, as well as how to install HD textures. But I'm also inspired by the likes of Modern Vintage Gamer, so I first want to cover this port in more detail. I want to tell you about the custom programming language developed by Naughty Dog, and how a small community decided to revive this language, document it with incredible detail, and subsequently reverse engineer Jak in such a way that we can now have a native x86 port available to us. Like I said, this is pretty different for me, so if you want to see me make more videos like this, make sure to hit the like button and let me know what you think in the comments. If you're new to this channel, I normally make PC gaming and Steam Deck videos, and if you fancy that sort of thing, be sure to hit subscribe and slap the bell. As a disclaimer for the regulars on my channel, I recorded a lot of this footage on my desktop. For Steam Deck specific footage, you'll see that with my typical Steam Deck border, and most of that footage will be left for the Steam Deck specific sections. All right, let's get into it. So what is decompilation and how does it enable people to make a native port of a game? For that, we have to start with processors. Processor families are built around some instruction set. You're probably familiar with some of these families like x86, ARM, Apple's M1, and in this case, PS2's MIPS. Well, each of these have their own instruction sets. These instructions make up the assembly language that is the lowest level of communication we can have with that processing unit. Modern assembly languages have a huge number of instructions, so it's impossible to convey the range of functionality in this short video. But as a very basic example, there are instructions for mathematical operations, memory access, and comparison operations. For a number of reasons, programmers today typically don't make games in an assembly language, however. It's more common to write software in a more platform-agnostic programming language, and through a number of steps, that can be compiled to target a specific instruction set, and therefore processor family. One of the reasons for using a high-level language is that it's more human-readable than assembly language. Another reason, as I alluded to, is that it's not specific to a given platform. Both of these things make porting the application to another platform easier. So when we have the source code for a given game, like we do with Doom, the community can relatively easily port that game to another platform. But what do we do when we don't have the source code? Well, the task becomes much more difficult, by orders of magnitude. With only the assembly code available to you, you have limited options. Assuming you're not going to emulate the source platform, your primary option is decompilation, a form of reverse engineering. There are automated decompilers that will take assembly language for a given platform and try to reconstruct it into C code or code for some other programming language. This is rather brute and results in extremely hard to read code as it has to generate things like variable names and function names by itself. Imagine that you have a function called add that takes two arguments and outputs the sum of those two. Now imagine that you call that function somewhere else in the code like this. Position equals add position and speed. This will set a position variable to the sum of the current position and the current speed. This is extremely readable, but after it gets compiled and then decompiled, it might look more like this. A equals Z, A, B. If you see the first line, you know what that means at a glance. The second is unreadable without more digging. So automated decompiling isn't enough. In the case of decompilation projects for Mario 64 and Ocarina of Time, a lot of manual work and care was taken to make the source code in the C language that was not just human readable, but extremely well documented. If I look at the code for the in-game camera system, there's nearly 50 lines of comments up front to let me know how this code works. So decompilation alone is challenging and arduous work, but Jak and Daxter introduces a unique challenge. It was written in a custom language called GOAL, short for Game-Oriented Assembly Lisp. You can consider this a dialect of another language called Lisp. Part of the challenge here is that there is no public specification for this bespoke dialect. Several people at Naughty Dog have talked about this language and their workflow and why it really works for them. They've even provided some code samples, but they've never given us more than that. So how can you reverse engineer when you don't even know what you're reverse engineering to? That's something I asked myself a lot in the research for this project. I know how to program, but I'm not experienced in reverse engineering, so I was a little at a loss. We'll come back to the subject shortly because, as I said, this was my main question throughout. But if you do some searching, you'll find people on various forums asking for more information on GOAL. It seems like Naughty Dog's own talks and presentations on the subject drummed up a lot of interest in game programmer circles. What are the benefits of GOAL, and why was it so intriguing? One major benefit is that Naughty Dog built what is called an interactive listener, so called because it listens for code updates made by the programmer. This allows the coder to make the changes to the code even as the game is running. No need for a reset, much less a rebuild of the code. This meant you can test an update in seconds rather than minutes or hours. GOAL also has special functionality for writing assembly code within it. This is commonly needed because sometimes you'll need to optimize code as much as possible, and the best way to do it is to write assembly yourself rather than let the compiler do it. But the point is that in GOAL, you could weave in and out of assembly more elegantly than you could with C. And there are more benefits, but the general idea is that GOAL was purpose-built for making video games, so much so that the benefits were able to outweigh the inherent drawbacks in creating and using a bespoke language. One such drawback is that people outside your company don't know how to use your language. Consequently, Naughty Dog decided to abandon use of the language when they were getting acquired by Sony. One of the reasons for the acquisition is that they were so technically proficient that Sony wanted them to share the knowledge with other in-house studios. That is a little more difficult to do when you use a language that no one else is using because you invented it. So they stopped using GOAL and went back to good old C for games like Uncharted. They later returned to GOAL for development of The Last of Us. So let's return to the question of how. How did these hobbyists reverse engineer into a language that there is no documentation for? And for what it's worth, I should mention these folks by name. A programmer by the name of Water111 is the maintainer and main contributor of the project. But there's also Vosser and Mandude who have contributed a ton, as well as 20-ish other contributors. So yeah, how was this accomplished? For a brief moment, I thought they actually had a Naughty Dog insider, but in reality, the answer was much, much simpler than that. The truth is that a lot of early PS2 games left debug information on the disk. Jak was one of those games. Usually these debug symbols got removed from a game by the time it went gold. This was especially true in the cartridge era where space was limited. But for Jak 1, there was so much information left on the disk, in fact, that Water111 jokes that, quote, "it's almost like they did it on purpose," end quote. The C code that exists was compiled with no optimization and includes debugging symbols, and because GOAL uses a string-based symbol table for things like global functions, global variables, and types, the developers of this project were able to get all of that data. Now, if we go back to my example of an add function, debug symbols help the reverse engineers reconstruct something closer to the original source code. That's a major oversimplification, and there is still a lot of manual work involved. For example, they'd still be missing things that were built into the original GOAL compiler or the names of non-global functions and variables. But hopefully this helps convey how they got the ball rolling. And so, starting in 2020, Water111, Vosser, and others wrote the OpenGOAL language. They wrote a decompiler that would take the Jak binaries and generate the OpenGOAL code. They also wrote a compiler that would compile OpenGOAL into x86 assembly, as well as an extractor that would extract the textures, audios, geometry, and other static content from a Jak disk or disk image. They also wrote extensive documentation on the language and have been pursuing the goal of a port that can be played from beginning to end since then. Needless to say, this has been a tremendous effort. The original Jak 1 game is estimated to have 20,000 lines of C, C++ code, and 500,000 lines of GOAL. Making matters worse, some of that GOAL code was actually inline assembly. The OpenGOAL developers created functions that would map to these instructions and had to tie it all together from the decompiler to the assembly emitter. All in all, this has been over 2 years of work to bring us what we have today. With that in mind, let me tell you how to get it running. If you have the right PS2 disk, it's actually pretty easy, but that's a big if. You see, there were a few prints of Jak, and so far the decompilation team have only written the extractor for one of these prints, the NTSC black label version. They plan on incorporating all of the versions of Jak that are out there, but for now, you'll need this one. Thankfully, it's pretty easy to find for less than 10 bucks. I'm going to leave the checksum for the disk in the description because it's important that it matches exactly. So enter that checksum into a search engine and you'll see a link to the Jak page on redump.org. This will give you the serial number to make sure you're searching for the right thing on eBay or whatever. Okay, so once you've extracted the image of the Jak game and verified the checksum, you can go to the GitHub page for the OpenGOAL project and click on releases. From here on out, I'm going to show you instructions on how to do this specifically on a Steam Deck because I am a Steam Deck channel. Download the latest file that ends in linux.tar.gz. That'll go to your downloads folder where you can extract it. Now place the resulting folder wherever you want. For example, you can put it in your games folder or on an SD card. I also renamed the folder to remove the version number because I'm going to be copying updates right into this folder. So from now on, I'm going to refer to it as the OpenGOAL directory. In any case, right click in the folder and click open in terminal. Run the extractor with your ISO file using this command. The extractor will get all the content from your ISO and place it into a directory. It will subsequently auto-launch the game, and here's where I added it to Steam. The game itself is the GK file in that same folder, so search for that when you're adding a game to Steam, but make sure to select all files since it looks for only .desktop files by default. Okay, now you should be able to swap back to gaming mode and it should run quite nicely. You can explore the options from here. The first thing I did is set the graphics and display option. I set it to borderless full screen and I kept the PS2 aspect ratio on. I also inverted one of the camera axes, but I'll let you play around with that and set it how you like. If you ever want to update to the latest release, this is currently pretty easy as well. Just download the latest, extract it, and copy its contents into the directory from before. You shouldn't need to re-extract the ISO, but every once in a while there may be a need, so if you run into any issues, just go ahead and re-extract. On that note, if you ever want to replace any textures, then you will in fact have to re-extract the ISO. For example, I'll link a YouTube video that has another link to some HD textures. If you download those, you'll get a texture replacements folder that you can then paste into your OpenGOAL/data directory. Now, in order to actually replace the textures, the extractor has to do its thing, so run the extractor again now that you have all your textures in place. When the game reruns, you should see your new textures. Even with HD textures, Jak and Daxter runs at a pretty solid 60 FPS with only very occasional drop frames. I wouldn't even notice them, and it doesn't seem to be because the deck can't handle it. There is a lot of headroom for both the GPU and CPU. In fact, the majority of the time I played it, Jak and Daxter burns less than 10 watts per hour, usually around 8. That means you can play for about 5 hours on one full charge. In other words, you can probably beat the game in 2 full charges. That's pretty fantastic. This is in contrast to the emulated Jak, which takes longer to load, doesn't look as good, and gets like 2 to 3 hours of battery life. The HD textures are mostly a matter of taste. They absolutely make the image quality even cleaner, but I could see someone saying that they lose a little charm in the process. I personally like them, especially in the HUD, where everything just looks a lot cleaner on the eyes. Overall, even at 80% completion, this is the definitive version of Jak and Daxter. It surpasses even the HD remaster on PS3. This game has aged well in both gameplay and art. While Naughty Dog is much more famous for their post-PS2 games, I think I have more of a fondness for this era of their work. They did a lot to perfect their prowess with designing platformers in Crash 1, 2, and 3, and it culminated in this collectathon swan song that I think aged better than Banjo-Kazooie and Donkey Kong 64. While Naughty Dog would continue the Jak franchise with a couple of sequels and spin-offs, this was Naughty Dog's last proper platformer. As such, I'm happy to see it live on in this way. So what's left for OpenGOAL? Well, a few things. With regard to Jak 1, I mentioned that they feel they are 80% done. They have some bugs to squash and potential features to add, including a launcher. They are also open to adding quality of life features and have an issue tracker for keeping track of these sorts of requests. They also intend to let you use other Jak 1 discs, like the Red Label version or even the PAL region discs. Of course, people have also already started working on mods too. Even beyond the texture replacements, I've seen a Mario Kart mod, and I'm sure that's only the beginning. Moreover, they don't want to stop at Jak 1. They've already begun work on Jak 2. There's nearly twice as much code for the sequel, but a lot of the work that was done for Jak 1 will still be applicable. Still, I'm sure it's going to be a while before we see this sequel. Finally, I wonder if OpenGOAL will renew interest in GOAL. In my research, I saw old posts on Reddit, Hacker News, Quora, and Stack Overflow from people over the years curious to learn more about Naughty Dog's mythical game programming language. I hope that some of those folks get to see all the wonderful work being done on OpenGOAL, and I hope we see some hobbyist game development in this obscure language, maybe even an OpenGOAL game jam. So I've been really fascinated with this project and I couldn't wait to talk about it. I'm going to borrow a quote here from Mitch Mitten, who wrote about this back in 2017. He said, quote, "It's a hell of a thing when you think about it, to create your own programming language from scratch and then write the entire game engine in it. I don't know of any other games out there that do that," end quote. I agree, but I want to know what you think. Are you going to play this Jak and Daxter port? Are you interested in the tech behind it? How do you think this engine stacks up against id Tech and Unreal of the time? And where do you rank Jak amongst Naughty Dog's games? Make sure to let me know in the comments. By the way, because this was such a departure for me, I almost made this a Patreon exclusive, but I ended up not doing that. So if you want to show some support anyway, be sure to check out my Patreon page and help me out there. All right, that gang out. Goodbye.